Hello, Mr. True again. Thank you very much for watching my videos and liking them and subscribing them. I'm really having a good time starting these video lectures for you this year. Today we're going to take a look and continue our discussion in statistics of scatter plots. Now, again, my notes are just at these big long note lecture things. They're just an outline of all the concepts that you do need to know. Please make sure you read your book thoroughly, look at those examples, do your homework, and use these as a guideline of like, hey, I should know all these facts. And then refer to them later when you start studying for your exams. So the other video I just did, we were looking at scatter plots, which was our first bivariate quantitative graph, where the x and the y-axis were numerical values. And we talked about how the x-axis was the explanatory variable and the y-axis was the response variable, and we made scatter plots. And we talked about how you would look at those and describe the form and direction and the strength of whatever pattern you happen to have showed up. We talked about correlation, which is R, the strength and direction of a linear relationship, R squared, and we also talked about lurking variables. So if you want to take a look at that video, please do. Well, now we're going to say, hey, I looked at these scatter plots, and they look like they're straight, or at least we think that those patterns that we're seeing in the plots look pretty straight. Well, if you've got a linear pattern in a scatter plot, whether it's going up or down, we can make a regression line, or a least squares regression line, that's what I'm talking about today, to put through those points and then use that least squares regression line to make estimates of y values, where we use the x values and make predictive y values, and basically allow that line to model the actual data and make predictive y values in places where we don't actually have any real values of x. So, what are some properties and things that you guys have to know about regression lines? Well, the form is y hat equals a plus bx, and y hat is read as the predicted y value. So when you see an actual point, it'll be x and y, and when you see x and then comma y hat, you'll know that that y hat is a predicted y value, or one that came from the regression line. A, and you might know from like y equals mx plus b, the slope-intercept form of a line, when you look at a line, the constant, or in this case a, is going to be the y-intercept. Now that is the place where you cross the y-axis when x is equal to 0. Our stats problems are all real applications, and the variables of x and y can take on any multitude of values. They're not all going to be centered around the origin. So the value of A, the y-intercept, and a lot of these problems, these application problems, don't actually have a real life interpretation. However, B does. B is a slope, and it always has a real interpretation. Please read those examples in your textbook about how to interpret slope. That's really, really important. When you get to the end of the test and you start doing linear regression t-tests, your full understanding of what slope is and being able to interpret it is a big, big deal. Well, what is slope? The idea of slope being rise over run is great for when you're drawing a graph in basic algebra, but it is not good for word problems, for application problems. So the real definition of slope is the average change in y per one unit of change in x. And in your word problems, when you're trying to interpret what the slope is, if you just take out the y and replace it with whatever it's about, blood pressure or stats or SAT math scores or whatever it is, just take the y out, plug in what is actually on your response variable in your word problem, and the x is, you know, whatever. If I'm talking about GPA and compared to future SAT math scores, then maybe the slope is the average change in the SAT math score per one unit of change in their GPA score. And so slope is average rate of change in y per one unit of change in x. So over here, we've got a little sketch. I've got 1, 2, 3, 4 points, and I'm drawing a regression line through those points. Now let me talk about why we call the regression line the least squares regression line. Well, you know, in algebra, and honestly this is all I did in this, on this drawing, when you did scatter plots in Algebra 1 and Algebra 2, Maybe you looked at scatter plots and you just sort of stuck a ruler and drew a line through those points and then used 2 points and a slope, or use those 2 points to find the slope and then find a equation of that fitted line, that best fit line. Well, that's all fine, but with the help of calculators and computers, we can actually properly place that line through those points. And how we actually place that line through those points, as hinted by the name least squares regression line, well, if you have a scattering of points, clearly the line which is perfectly straight is not going to hit any of those points. It might not hit any of the points. So you're always going to have these vertical distances between the actual data points, in this case there's 4 of them, and the regression line. Those vertical distances that I've highlighted in green, if you're watching this on a computer with the high def thing turned on, the 720p, those vertical distances are called residuals. We use our x values, our x explanatory variables, to help predict the response variable of y. So every time you make a prediction, you might make a mistake. No, I just pointed to the actual point. So here I have the actual point of x, y, and then I have a predicted point that's on the regression line of x, y hat. Again, that's predicted y value. Well, there's an error there. You can't help but make a mistake or an error with your predictions, but that vertical distance is a big deal, and it's called a residual, and that vertical distance is calculated by doing y minus y hat. If your residual is negative, this y value is bigger than the actual y value of the points. When you do y minus y hat, you'll get a negative difference. So when your points are below the line, your residuals are negative, and when your points are above the line, like these two, your residual is going to be positive. So some residuals are positive, some are negative. Well, those vertical distances, if we add them, always comes up to be zero, kind of like the distance between all your individual points and the mean when you're finding standard deviation. Those distances between your data points and the mean is always zero. So the regression line has something to do with averages. Every regression line does go through the point mean of x, mean of y. Another important property of regression lines. Well, if these residuals always add up to zero, then we can't just add them all up because we'd always get an answer from zero. So what we do is, graphically, we square them, and the sum of those squared residuals needs to be as small as possible. And when that sum gets to be as small as possible, then your least squares regression line is in the proper place. So, basic definition of what a regression line is, how you place it, how you read it. Let's move on. Okay, when you take the AP exam, they try and ask you questions that prevent you basically from being completely dependent on your calculator. And here we have one of those examples and some formulas that you will find on your formula sheet when you take the AP stats exam. Find a regression line with descriptive statistics. The slope of a regression line is equal to the correlation value, the strength and direction of your linear relationship, times the standard deviation of y over the standard deviation of x. A, which is your y-intercept, is equal to the mean of y minus b times the mean of x. And here's a reminder off of your formula sheet that every regression line goes to the point mean of x, mean of y. What is the equation of the regression line of y on x, that's the standard language in your textbook, for data with the following characteristics? The mean of x is 10, the standard deviation of your x values is 2, the mean of y is 30, and the standard deviation of y is 12, and the correlation coefficient is 0.33, so we have a fairly weak linear relationship. Well, first we find out what the slope is. That's the correlation value, r, times the standard deviation of y, so you'll have to read your problem and recognize what is going to be your x and y axis or your explanatory response variable. The standard deviation of x is 2. And that comes out to b is equal to 0.33 times 6. And 0.33 is a fraction, is like 1/3. So 6 divided by 3 is about 2. Okay. Well, now I've got my slope over my regression line. A is equal to the mean of y, which is 30, minus b, which we just found to be 2, times the mean of x, which I've given to you as a value of 10. So that means that a is going to be 30 minus 20, or 10. So my regression line going through a scatter plot with this with these characteristics would be y hat equals a plus b x. This is not a question that you do tremendously often in the textbook, but it is a very, very good question for an AP exam or a chapter test, because I can ask you for the regression of the or the equation of the regression line, and I'm preventing you from just tippity-tapping all the data in the calculator and doing a stats calculation automatically. So I'm sort of like using, I'm making sure that you know the concepts and the formulas and not just depending completely on your calculator. So pay attention to this question, even though that seemed relatively basic. Now this y on x is also language that you might find in your word problem that will help you identify what should be the x-axis and what should be the y-axis, because it's always y on x. Woo! All right, moving on. Okay, I got 3 minutes left, and I'll do my last bit of this notes in a separate video. Properties of regression lines, one more time. They all pass through the mean of x and mean of y. The sum of the residuals is always zero. Placed so the sum of the residual squared is as small as possible. I just verbalized that over there. It's not a resistant measure. That's supposed to be an A, I think. It's not a resistant measure. Because you're using the means in the calculation of a regression line, so it's not resistant to normal outliers or influential points. Remember, normal outliers are outliers in the vertical direction, and influential points are outliers in the horizontal direction. And they have a lot more influence over the slope and the y-intercept of the regression line. We don't want outliers ever. Influential ones are even worse, though. And this repeats what I just said. Regression lines are not resistant. Requires we have an explanatory and response variable, meaning that if you have a regression line and you flip the x and y axis for some reason, maybe you want to do, you're predicting, you want to switch what you're predicting, because you always predict the y values. Well, if you do that, your x and y axis are going to change, your slope is going to change, your y-intercept is going to change, so you don't have to have a clear explanatory variable, but what's on the x-axis and what's on the y-axis will determine the slope and y-intercept. If you switch those around, of course they're going to change, hence the statement. However, as you will see in one of my calculator videos, when you switch the x and y-axis, that's not going to change the strength of the linear relationship. So, you know, where the slope and the y-intercept will change with the regression line, r and r squared, the correlation coefficient and the determination of coefficients, I just said that wrong, excuse me, will stay the same. R and R squared does not care what you set as the x and y axis.
Ooh, I do have 1:30 left.
So, I know this is quick, but you can pause at any point and write these notes down and rewatch this. So my kids in class won't have that option. Here's some minitab output that has some numbers, and we're not going to learn what they mean until probably chapter 14 or 15 or whatever book you have that does linear regression t-tests. But I want to talk about how to read this part of the minitab output so you can write the equation of a regression line from computer output. And some AP exam questions have actually had this skill as part of one of their questions. Well, the regression equation is a plus bx. And what do we call a number when it's off by itself? A constant. Well, the coefficient of the constant is 7.4, so the a comes out, and 7.4 comes in its place, and then the second number, or the second line of that minitab output will always be about what's on the x-axis. What's the coefficient of GPA? So maybe we're using GPA to predict your SAT BAS scores. Well, the slope, or the coefficient of the x variable, is 12.3. And bam, I just looked at some minitab output, and from that wrote the equation of the regression line. I did finish. Woo! Bam! Have a great day.